point our search for India's roots to the village. This is Kasambi on the Jamna River, south of Delhi. The village has been the basis of Indian life for thousands of years. Two-thirds of her population of 850 million still live in places like this. And absorbing the invasions of Aryans, Muslims and British, it was the village which preserved the essential values of Indian culture. The key to those values is the deep-rooted belief that all life is sacred. In the overfed and secular West, the idea of the sacred cow may be meaningless, but here, for poor people, it pulls loads, gives milk, butter, fuel, manure. And to kill it is literally sacrilege. The basic beliefs of Hinduism reinforce this idea of the connectedness of life. At a village shrine, one of the highest priestly caste offers a libation and a Sanskrit prayer. This black stone icon, descended from the phallic stones of Mohenjo-Daro, is the mark of the god Shiva, a symbol of the life force. This well is used by the lowest caste, the untouchables, who do the dirtiest jobs. The caste system is an elaborate, graded form of social segregation based on what job you do. But it may have begun with colour, a kind of apartheid, keeping the light-skinned Aryan invaders separate from the conquered, darker-skinned native peoples. In the first millennium BC, the fusion of the Aryan newcomers and the elder culture bore fruit in some of the greatest spiritual works of humanity. And amazingly, these ancient poems are still the most popular diet for mass audiences in India today. Especially the Mahabharata. Today's episode is virtually the Indian gospel, the Gita.
Kutastra kashmala midam vishame samupasthitam anarya jushtam aswargyam akirtikaram arjuna.
It is obsession with the senses and the material life, says the divine Krishna, which is the ruin of reason and will destroy humanity itself. India's conscience is perhaps her greatest gift to the world. Around 500 BC, city life revived in the Ganges Valley, and a renaissance took place as glorious as the age of Pericles in Greece. At its center was Benares. For the pilgrims bathing here on the morning of Shiva's festival day, Shivaratri, the city of Shiva is beyond time and history, a place of redemption. Every pious Hindu hopes to come here once in a lifetime to bathe in Mother Ganges. On the riverbank, pilgrim guides tell of the deeds of Shiva on earth. to religious tourists from all over India. As early as the first millennium BC, the Mahabharata visualized India as one motherland united through pilgrimage. And this vast and continuous recirculation of money, people, and ideas is what has given India the unity which it never had in politics until the British came.
So you've been to Bajnath. Bajnath, you have been.
These men are typical of the thousands here today. Poor agricultural laborers from a village near Kosambi. In the last few days, they've traveled by bus a 2,000-mile round trip, visiting shrines high up into the Himalayas. They've spent their entire savings for the year. We do it, they say simply, because our ancestors did it. The rich are here too. This is the Maharaja of Banaras. He's revered by many as the living representative of Shiva on earth.
This is the most famous of
At the heart of the sacred city is a labyrinth of narrow alleys. In the very center is a small Shiva temple viewed by the pilgrims as the most sacred in India. It's the goal of everyone tonight, bearing their pots of Ganges water. In the inner sanctum, the simple black stone is submerged with offerings of milk and flowers. These ancient rituals connect the worshippers with their deity, but also their history, their myths, and their deepest racial memories. Western civilization saw one god who stood outside his creation. India saw numberless aspects of the same divinity, unity and diversity. Each was a vision deeply rooted in the distinctive character of its own civilization. Away from the gaudy tumult of Banaras, in about 500 BC, a young Indian prince preached a sermon which would change the world. His name was Gautam, and we know him as the Buddha. I have reached the conviction, he said, that human suffering must be comprehended. The Buddha's answer to the perennial question was simple and typically Indian. It is attachment to the senses and to material desires, he said, which is the root of all human unhappiness. Get rid of those desires and you'll find the path to salvation.
The period of the Buddha's lifetime, from the 6th to the 5th century BC, has been called the Axis Age, because so many of the great thinkers in world history were alive at the same time. The Buddha and Mahavira in India, Pythagoras and the early Greek philosophers, The greatest of the Old Testament prophets like Isaiah, Confucius, Lao Tzu, and the Taoists in China, and even some have thought Zoroaster in Persia. It's extraordinary to think that many of those people could actually have met each other. It suggests that the ancient world, which had emerged from the first civilizations of Iraq and Egypt, China and India, was undergoing a crisis of spirit, but also a crisis of opportunity. Fundamental questions were being asked about the nature of God, about the meaningfulness of life on earth, and about the basis of the authority for kings and states. And at the heart of that, the question which still plagues governments even today in the United States and the Soviet Union. How do you persuade your citizens to act as moral beings? How do you persuade them to be good? The different ways in which those civilizations attempted to come to terms with these questions still shape them and us today. The Near East took the path of monotheism, which would become central to the ideology of the West as well as Islam. China, the Confucian conception of the individual, the family, and the state in a perfectible moral order on earth. Whereas in India, the great tradition asserted that this earthly material life is simply illusion, and that true enlightenment can only come by forsaking it, the absolute opposite of the Western ideology. And so the social and economic character of these great cultural blocks is still shaped by that revolutionary epoch, even today.
मुझको यारा तू जरा सा कर इशारा दिल जला के जगमगा दूं मैं तेरे रास्ते मेरे जैसा इश्क में पागल फिर मिले या ना मिले कल सोचना क्या हाथ ये दे दे मेरे हाथ में हाँ कुट्टी मोहब्बत ने अंगड़ाई ली दिल का सौदा
You are an insane man.
नच कोयलों पे रात बिताई है, अखियों की नींद मैंने फूकों से उड़ा दी, दिल दिल तारे मैंने उंगली जलाई है।
जमाल मलिक गरबा गरम चाय देने वाला फ्रॉम मुंबई, लेट्स प्ले। कौन बनेगा
Dude, you just cut off that guy. Pissed off.
Two are followers of the world's oldest living god, the creator and destroyer, the man-woman, the great yogi, Shiva himself. India was one of the earliest of the great civilizations, and it defined the goals of civilized life very differently from the West. The West raised individualism, materialism, rationality, masculinity as its ideals. India's great tradition insisted on non-violence, renunciation, the inner life, the female as pillars of civilization. And through all the triumphs and disasters of her history, she hung on to that ideal, an eternal quest to identify humanity with the whole of creation. A unity in diversity. As our troubled century draws to its close, a deeper understanding of the achievements of other civilizations has become a necessity. As Mark Twain said here a century ago, the Indians may seem poor to we rich Westerners, but in matters of the spirit, it's we who are the paupers and they who are the millionaires. History is full of empires of the sword, but India alone created an empire of the spirit.
Yeah. Was Babur.
How did they kill him?
It was British revolt, Indian revolt against British,
yeah.
And they had to like kill him. So the first Mughal emperor was Babur. Now he was the fifth Mughal emperor, Shahjahan. The sixth is Aurangzeb, and last one is Babur, which was second. So. At the time of Akbar, like the third Mughal emperor, fourth Mughal emperor, and fifth Mughal emperor, Shahjahan, that was the golden age of the Mughal dynasty. Mm-hmm. So this time, the Mughals have a good power and good wealth, and they have big territories and everything like that. You know, when the Mughals came in India, that time the whole country, the whole nation is not one country. India is what is called slow provinces. So like we have Turkish, Lodi.
What is this part?
Man called Jahangir. So he was the son of the man built, father of the man built Taj Mahal. So Shahjahan's father was Jahangir, this was his palace. It's called Jahangiri Mahal. Mahal means palace. You see the river view, you watch it from here. But later it was used by the two daughters of Shahjahan. When mother is passed, it was used by two daughters of Shahjahan, Roshanara and Jahangir. That's the tower where he was imprisoned. From there he can see Taj Mahal, sitting here for his 5 years. And this is a beautiful garden, it's called the Grapes Garden. It used to be grapes, but it's called the Grapes Garden.
Thank you.
Once a year, the image of the goddess is taken to the banks of a sacred lake to celebrate her marriage to Shiva. There, she and her consort are serenaded with haunting hymns in Tamil, perhaps the living descendant of the language of the Indus cities. The great goddess, the Indians say, is the cause of all. She is peace, all forms of faith, ever in all things, and pervading all creation. And now, the last and perhaps most fateful invasion of India took place. Soon she could be depicted as a naked black female, submissively offering her riches to Britannia. India entered the cataclysmic epoch which has left few native cultures of the world intact, the era of colonialism. The natural resources of India were plundered. Her trees and animals, which Ashoka had protected 2,000 years before, were thoughtlessly consumed. The Indians, bearers of the world's oldest civilization, were treated like children by people who saw themselves as the superior race. In fantastical costumes and invented ceremonies, the rulers of a small island 5,000 miles away glorified themselves. How easy it is to forget that there was an India before the British came, which is still there now they've gone. And for all the achievements of the British, their most fateful legacy was to open up India irrevocably to a wider world. Europeans first discovered that India's sacred language, Sanskrit, the root of all the North Indian dialects, was akin to Greek and Latin. The oldest living language, it had entered India in the second millennium BC with Aryan invaders. And the earliest and most revered Sanskrit literature comes from that time.
Of all the great collection of Sanskrit sacred texts, known collectively as the Vedas, the oldest is the Rig Veda. It comprises about 1,000 archaic chants and hymns, older even than Homer's Iliad and Odyssey, preserved over an immense period of time by oral transmission. This is the oldest surviving written text of the Rig Veda, and it dates only from the 14th century AD. But the first hymns in this collection could have been composed as early as 2000 BC. The tale they tell seems to be one of the migration of groups of Sanskrit-speaking peoples who called themselves Aryans, literally the noble ones, a migration into northern India. It suggests that they found there, when they arrived, a civilization which was already thriving, with cities and towns and forts, rich in cattle and treasure, with a dark-skinned population who contrasted with the light-complexioned northerners, the Aryans. The Rig Veda implies a long period of interaction between the two cultures, but it also certainly suggests that in places the Aryans destroyed the towns and cities of the native population, subdued them, and carved up their land for settlement. The location of these contacts and battles is made quite clear in the poems. It's that historical battleground extending from the Kabul River in Afghanistan through the Khyber Pass down into what is now Pakistan and into the Punjab, the area called by the Aryans Sapta Sindava, the seven rivers, the greatest of which was the Indus.
From the very beginning, rivers were sacred to Indian culture, literally the source of life. And the first Indian cities grew up on the rich alluvial soil left by the annual flooding of the Indus.
Greatest game there is. Right, Hardy?
Yes, sir.
The greatest game there will ever be.
Just you and the ball.
All by your lonesome.
Hey.
I think it's time.
Time for what?
Time for you to see the field.
The field? I see the field, but it's 445 yards long. It's got a little red flag at the end of it. It's 12 strokes ahead of me. Come on.
That ain't it. Because if you seen the field, you wouldn't be hacking at that ball like you was chopping weeds out from under your front porch.
Just give me the club.
Sorry I brought it up. Here, you gonna take that hack away.
What's the field?
Fix your eyes on Bobby Jones.
He needs a piece of work here right now.
Well, give the man room. Man room. Knock it out there, Bobby.
Practice swing. Almost like he's searching for something. Then he finds it. Watch how he settles itself right into the middle of it. Feel that focus. And he got a lot of shots he could choose from. Duffs and tops and skulls. There's only one shot that's in perfect harmony with the field. One shot that's his. Authentic shot. And that shot is going to choose him. There's a perfect shot out there trying to find each and every one of us. All we got to do is get ourselves out of its way. Let it choose us. Look at him. He in the field. You can't see that flag as some dragon you got to slay. You have to look with soft eyes. See the place where the tides and the seasons and the turning of the earth all come together. Where everything that is becomes one. You got to seek that place with your soul, Juno. Seek it with your hands. Don't think about it. Feel it. Your hands is wiser than your head ever gonna be. Now, I can't take you there, Juno. Just hopes I can help you find a way. It's just you, that ball, that flag, and all you are. Seek it with your hands. Don't think about it.
Feel
it.
Looking at it, Juna.
Feel it. It's just
There's
you.
There's only one shot up that's in perfect that ball, harmony. You don't see that.
It's the home of your authentic swing. That flag, and all that you are.
Blind squirrel finds an acorn now and then, Bobby.
There's no way. I only get that on the green.
You gonna be wanting a different club, Dale, Junior?
I can't do this.
Hey, you might should just loose your grip up a smidge. You know, a man's grip on his club just like a
it's
man's
not what
grip
I'm
on.
Talking about.
I know.
No, you don't.
What I'm talking about is a game. A game that can't be won. Only played.
You don't understand.
I don't need to understand. Ain't a soul on this entire earth ain't got a burden to carry. He don't understand. You ain't alone in that. But you've been carrying this one long enough. Time to go on, lay it down.
I don't know how.
You got a choice. You can stop, or you can start.
Start?
Walking.
Where?
Right back to where you always been, and then stand there. Still. Real still. And remember.
It's too long ago.
Oh, no, sir. It was just a moment ago. Time for you to come on out the shadows, Juno. Time for you to choose.
I can't.
Yes, you can. But you ain't alone. I'm right here with you. I've been here all along. I played a game. Your game, the one that only you was meant to play. One that was given to you when you come into this world. You ready? Well, take your stance. Strike that ball, Junior. Don't hold nothing back. Give it everything. Now's the time. Let yourself remember. Remember your swing. That's right, Junior. Settle yourself. Let's go. Now is the time, Junior.
A little bit right. Hit the tree. Oh,
and outside Taj Mahal is there.
I think the monkeys are gonna fall. Give me back my ball, you monkeys! Give me back my ball! Give it back! Bad monkeys! I think pitching wedge.
Yeah.
Taj Mahal with Sham.
Yeah. Witnessing the worst round of golf ever, right? Can you hit? Yeah. Who's the worst player?
Yeah, you are.
So see you later.
See you soon.
How you say in your language? See you later.
Baad mein milte hain. Nice, but
the worst.
First time playing.
Yeah. Alright, my friend. Hey, we're gonna try to get 9 more holes in. He's got a flashlight, okay? You can wait for us, 9 more holes. I just found something for my daughter.
Faster.
Ha ha! Before you get a bit of sit down.
Oh, yes, Commissioner. Very good, sir. Sergeant Judo and I will get right on it. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir, of course. Adieu.
Thank you.
How are you doing that?
It's a magic carpet.
It's lovely.
You don't want to go for a ride, do you? We could get out of the palace, see the world.
Is it safe?
I can show you the world, shining, shimmering, splendid. Tell me, princess, now when did you last let your heart decide? I can open your eyes, take you wonder by wonder, over, sideways, and under, on a magic carpet ride.
Search has brought us back finally to Allahabad and to the family house of the Nehrus. In this room, Indian Democrats met to discuss what India's future path should be. Their hopes and fears have been echoed time and again in our modern world. How far should the Western model be followed? Capitalism, democracy, Western science. How far can indigenous traditions work as the basis of a modern state? Nehru, the first Prime Minister, thought European models were the way forward and came to believe in a complete break with the ancient past. His friend Mahatma Gandhi, whose bedroom this is, had faith in India's own path, in self-cultivation, in local economies and village democracy, in Ashoka's principle of non-violence. For him, the greatest legacy any civilization has is simply itself.
The modern state of India, conceived and argued over only half a century ago in this house, in fact, rests on a great tradition extending back thousands of years with an amazing cultural continuity which has reasserted itself time and time again, and which brings the ideals of the Buddha and Ashoka and Akbar converging on this house like thought lines. India has been prodigiously gifted and creative in every field of human endeavor. If we were to choose one characteristic legacy, and it would be a Western choice, then perhaps it is that India placed the spiritual quest at the center of life in the way that no other civilization did. But India also had a deep-rooted secular tradition extending back as far as the time of Ashoka. And this tradition deeply impressed Nehru and his friends as they attempted to frame a new constitution for their new secular state. They were also inspired, as we can see from the books on Nehru's shelves, by the egalitarian tradition developed in the West through the revolutions in England and America, in France and Russia, although some of those ideals were at odds with the great tradition. And both those great currents went into the modern state of India. Which way the great tradition will go in the 21st century, history cannot tell us. But it's worth recording that in the 1990s, the greatest audiences on television in India still came to watch the Gita, the most ancient and the most authentic tradition of life in India, with its assertion that moral enlightenment is the goal of every citizen in life. And here too, in the Nehru House in Allahabad, a thumbed boyhood copy of the Gita lay at Nehru's bedside from childhood to old age. So perhaps it is still true at the end of the 20th century, true for nations as well as people, that we may know our ends by our beginnings.
Outside the Nehru House, the climax of the Kumbh Mela has arrived. The greatest gathering of people ever seen on earth are waiting for dawn, when led by the naked renouncers of this world, they will bathe in the sacred river, in Mother Ganges, the symbol of India's age-long civilization.
Thank you. Virginia. Michelle. মই মানে এইটো কথা
বুজিছো
বুজিছে
নুবুজিম মানে ছোৱালী মাক বাপেকৰ পৰিচয় আপোনালোকে নাজানে সেইটো
হয় এওঁ সম্বন্ধীয় বায়েক এগৰাকীয়ে হস্পিটেলত এখন কৰে
শুৱনি কৰিবলৈ কিন্তু নগদ 2000 টকা খৰচ হ'ব
হওক তাই যদি ভাল হয় 2000 টকানো কি
হ'ব ঈশ্বৰৰ কৃপাত সেইখিনি পাৰিম মানে শক্তি মোৰ আছে
Because?
Just because.
Hey, Salim! Hey, Sharam, under to Salim!
Yeah, I've got final answer.
Give up!
Yes, final answer A. Aramis.
Computer J, lock kiya jaye.
Salim!
Jamal Malik. Call center assistant from Mumbai. Chaiwala. For 2 crore, 20 million rupees. You were asked who the third musketeer was in the novel by Alexander Dumas. You answered, hey, Aramis. Which is, I have to tell you, the right answer!
Can you
watching.
Hello. This is supposed to be our wedding day. Wow. Wow. Happy anniversary. Happy
coming back when life fit into our village. Now you can see the magic of the rock. You bring back.
Yes. I understand its power now.
You could have kept it.
What for? They'd just put it in a museum, it'd be another rock collecting dust.
But then it would have given you your fortune and glory.
Anything could happen. It's a long way to Delhi.
No, thanks. No more adventures with you, Dr. Jones.
Sweetheart, after all the fun we've had together.
you think I'm going to Delhi with you or any place else after all the trouble you've gotten me into, think again, Buster. I'm going home to Missouri where they never feed you snakes before ripping your heart out and lowering you into hot pits. This is not my idea of a swell time. Excuse me, sir. I need a guide to Delhi. If you could show me the way...
Bye, bunny.